இது சி த ப்ரோஷர் விச் யூ சென்ட் ஃபஸ்ட்டு கார்டியாலஜிஸ்ட் பேர் పెట్టాలండి ఫస్ట్ చెప్పండి మీరు ఫస్ట్ స్వాప్ చేయమనండి ఇంకా టైం ఉంది కదా ఓకే You got it?
No, I didn't.
See now? Lot of people are joining.
Yes, sir. I am not able to see that.
ఎవరు ఎవరు ఆపేసింది
going to wake up
and mute there like Yeah, good afternoon, Anand.
Good
nice
afternoon.
To see you.
Good afternoon, sir.
I think we have one more minute to start. Can you mute everybody except Dr.
Anand?
Can you mute everybody except Dr. Anand?
First PTC engagement ga evardu baitiki vesa lekka
let it go to next 1 minute then we stop.
మనోడు ఫస్ట్ పీటీసీ గైస్ చేసాడా
ప్లీజ్ మ్యూట్ యువర్ గైస్
రారు డిసెంబర్
వి కెన్ మ్యూట్ ఆల్సో Okay, good afternoon everybody. Today we are going to have continuation of the angiograms. Yesterday we had a little bit of a discussion and AP view some of the examples. Today we have a faculty from Jayadeva Institute of Medical Sciences at Bangalore. Dr. Anand Subramaniam is a professor of pediatric cardiology. If I'm correct, they got the eligibility for the DM pediatric cardiology course. Is it correct, Anand?
Yes, sir.
I congratulate you. And he's a great teacher. And we got opportunity that he worked with us as well. Dr. Anand is very much knowledgeable and going to actually interact with you after probably 5 minutes of our yesterday's case example. So let us see yesterday's case example. Any volunteers are there to take this case?
Yes, sir.
Any volunteers?
Yes, sir. Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Please identify yourself and then Guptuja, you have been talking. I am not going to allow you.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Anand, sir.
Anand, please open your microphone. Anand also came, no, several times. Give opportunity yes. to others, Anand.
Yes, sir.
Anybody? If nobody is there, then I can ask Anand or Guptuja.
Pressure.
Any other? Nobody is there. Can Anand, can you open your microphone then? Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Please go ahead, Anand.
Yeah, this is a cath date of 2 years old.
Hello. Better, buddy.
Yeah, please, sir. Yes, sir. This is a cath date of 2 years old child with the findings of atrial septal defect.
Saturation data,
sir. SVC is showing 88%, which is abnormal. IVC 66%, which is within the normal range. RA saturation is 87%, which is also an abnormal range. RV and pulmonary artery saturations are almost all equal to the RA saturation. So right side saturation.
Can you all put your microphone back? Anand, you can unmute your microphone. Yeah.
So right side chambers cath data, SVC 88%, which is abnormal. IVC 66%, which is within the normal range. RA saturation 87%, which is also abnormal. From RA to pulmonary artery, there is no further increase in saturation. So coming to the saturation of right side chambers, SVC is abnormal, sir. So some abnormal connection.
What is that? Abnormal means what is that you are telling?
Pulmonary veins. Pulmonary veins.
What are the reasons for high SVC saturation?
Anomalous pulmonary venous connection of SVC type.
Okay.
If there is a sinus venosus type of ASD also, there is a chance of...
Very good. Good answer. Suppose you have a one-year-old child who is deeply sedated, anesthetized.
Yes.
So your cerebral oxygen perfusion is less. Then you can have high SVC saturation. Suppose you have a 6 months old or 3 months old baby with vein of Galen malformation, that is arteriovenous fistula in the circle of villi, then you can have SVC saturation. But here it is not SVC saturation alone. SVC, RA, LA, PA, RV, LV, iota, yes. All are more or less
saturation.
lesser than 5% of saturation difference, what does it indicate? What is that called as?
Admixture physiology.
So this is called as equalization of saturations.
Okay.
So equalization of saturations in all chambers suggestive of it is equalization of saturations in all chambers. It is going to be anomalous, total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. So usually the admixture taken place very well when the pulmonary veins are connected, high SVC. SVC innominate vein or vertical vein is coming to the innominate vein, then the admixture will be taken place very well and they will have a good admixture in all chambers. Suppose you have an intracardiac TAPVR coronary sinus tie, you may not have that kind of admixture. So you may not see equalization of saturation. That is called as unfavorable streaming or favorable streaming. So in this particular patient, equalization of saturations are there. What are the pulmonary artery pressures in this patient?
Coming to the pressure data, sir, RA pressure and LA pressure are equal, mean pressure. So non-restrictive ASD. Mean pulmonary artery pressure is 23. So it is more than 20. According to the new guidelines, mild PAH is there.
Okay.
And
so if you are thinking it is a anomalous pulmonary venous return, total anomalous pulmonary venous connection.
Yes, sir.
Why there is no pulmonary hypertension in this patient? Why child is surviving till 12 years of age? So you tell me what are the factors which make them no pulmonary hypertension, no heart failure in the beginning, and they tend to survive till late childhood, even adulthood. What are the subset of
pulmonary stenosis, sir?
Pulmonary.
If there is associated pulmonary stenosis, there will be a decreased blood flow.
Not agreeing. Anybody would like to answer chat box? Yeah, non-restrictive ventricular septal defect, atrial septal defect, number one. Number two, good right ventricular complex. Right ventricle is a distendable structure like a balloon. It dilates. In case of neonates with TAPVR, what will happen? The right ventricle will be stiff. It will never lose its, the PVR will never fall. The complaints will never reduce. It's a stiff right ventricle. That's why they will have heart failure and early development of pulmonary hypertension. So in this particular subset of population, there is good RV complaints. There are no obstruction to the pulmonary veins. And there is a non-restrictive atrial septal defect. These are the three important features of why they don't develop pulmonary hypertension. So that is the today's case example. A case of a total anomalous pulmonary venous connection, supracardiac, with no significant pulmonary hypertension, which is operable. So do you have any idea about what is the favorable streaming, what is the unfavorable streaming? Suppose in supracardiac TAPVR, you have LA saturation, FA saturation is higher than the PA saturation. Here, FA saturation is equal to the PA saturation. PA saturation 88, FA saturation 88. Suppose you have, imagine a scenario, FA saturation is 92 and PA saturation is 80 or 82. That is called as favorable streaming. That means oxygenated blood predominantly going to the left atrium through a AST, which is probably malaligned, or SVC is straddling towards the LA, will have more oxygenated blood, will go to the left-sided circulation. Unfavorable streaming means, suppose you have a situation where PA saturation is higher than the aortic saturation. Aortic saturation is 80, whereas the PA saturation is more than 90. That means oxygenated blood is going to be more into the PA rather than to the systemic circulation. That is unfavorable circulation. Most of the supracardiac TAPVR will have equalization of saturations. So that's why the discussion of favorable, unfavorable will not come. Whereas intracardiac TAPVR, which is draining to the coronary sinus, will have predominantly unfavorable streaming, where the more saturated blood will go to the right ventricle. Whereas infradiaphragmatic TAPVR, where it is draining to the inferior vena cava, ductus venosus, hepatic veins, the oxygenated blood will go predominantly from the IVC through foramen of well to the LA. But those patients are very sick. So thank you very much for the day. You can put off your microphone. I will ask request Dr. Anand. Anand, can you please unmute your microphone? Yeah. So Dr. Anand is going to show examples. And please discuss Anand with them. And you take your own time. There is no pressure at all. I am just going to observe. I am putting my microphone off here.
You can keep it on, sir. Like comments from you also during the course of the discussion.
I stopped my screen. You can open your screen. Can you do now? It is possible because I allowed. And now you will be able to do.
Yeah, is it seen?
Yeah, it is seen.
Okay. Okay, so we'll start with some straightforward cases first, and then after that I'll try to present some rarer scenarios. So this is the first one. This is a 13-year-old child. I have put some brief pressure data, so I know the focus is going to be on the angiograms, but some of the hemodynamics are important. I mean, it's difficult to interpret angiograms in isolation. So if someone can just observe this data and just share your views and ideas on what's the scenario about.
Yes, sir. Sir, good afternoon, sir. Dr. Murtaza here.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Sir, this is a this is the pressure data of a 13-year-old child, which is showing the aortic pressure to be 115/62, and the mean pressure is 80, which is normal. The pulmonary arterial pressure is 15/10 with a mean pressure of 12. So this is a also normal. The left ventricular and the right ventricular systolic pressures and the diastolic pressures and diastolic pressures are equal. So this signifies that there is a non-restrictive VSD between the two.
Okay.
And since the PA pressure is normal, it means that this is a large VSD with PS is there, sir.
Correct. Yeah. So what do you expect the saturation in this child to be? If I can just ask you that.
Since there is severe PS, sir, I expect the saturation to be around 70 to 80%.
Yeah, basically, you're dealing with a cyanotic patient. That's what I wanted to know.
Yes.
Okay. So,
sir, why the LV pressures are lower than the aortic pressures, sir? Systolic pressures.
You will have some peripheral amplification, isn't it? So, if you take it exactly at the aortic root, you may have the same pressures. But if you take it slightly distally, your systolic pressures might be slightly high. It can go up to around 10 mm more. Okay, so someone can, I think Murtaza, you can start into reading the angiograms, or someone else wants to do it.
Yes, sir. This is the first angiogram. This is a AP view in which a catheter is shown. It seems to be a multipurpose catheter. The course of the catheter is from the femoral vein, IVC, RA, RV to PA. And the we can see that the branch pulmonary arteries, both the branch pulmonary arteries can be seen in this with good arborization of the lung fields. And in the levo phase, we can see the venous return into the LA.
Yeah, just a few corrections in this. So you knew that this was some kind of a top physiology to start with. You said that from your hemodynamics. So the view you said is an AP view. Do you just want to, do you still feel it's AP, or do you want to just refine yourself slightly there?
It is, sir, LAO cranial view.
Yeah. So it's slightly of an LAO cranial view. So you can do an AP cranial as well. So the first angiogram in most TOF cases would be to kind of visualize the pulmonary arteries, isn't it? So you would have to give an RV angiogram. And this is actually a pigtail catheter. It's not a multipurpose catheter. And you can see that it is placed somewhere close to the RV outflow tract. And you can make out the narrowing of your hypertrophied right ventricle. A lot of muscle bundles there. And like what you said, the main pulmonary artery and the branch pulmonary arteries are good sized. Yeah, I think someone's drawing on the screen. So if you can just. Okay. Okay. And what's the angiogram on the bottom right? What does that show?
Sir, the angiogram on the right side, it shows this view is in LAO cranial view, and it is done, the angiogram has been done with a pigtail catheter. And course of the catheter is from the femoral artery to the descending aorta into the aortic arch into the LV. And okay, so we can see that there is filling up of the PAs also in this case, sir.
Okay.
And both the ventricles are opacified, signifying that there is unrestricted VSD.
Okay. So this was a 13-year-old boy. So why did we do an LV angiogram? We don't know. Is it a must to do LV angiograms in all cases of Fallot's child, or are there any specific indications in which you might want to do it? Murtaza, are you there, or is someone else going to take my question?
So to look for any additional VSDs.
Yeah, correct. So it was basically to look for any additional VSDs, which is not there in this patient. So especially in older children, the degree of RV hypertrophy and the stiffness of the right ventricle increases progressively with age. And obviously small additional muscular defects might be missed because both the RV and LV are at the same pressure. So sometimes it might be difficult to visualize that on echocardiography. Okay, and try and get as much information as you can, because a lot of times when you do an LV angiogram, you also see the aortic root in these cases. So the coronaries may be visualized. Of course, this is very classical, so I'm going to show you one in which all of them are seen. Okay. Someone else?
This is a pigtail angiogram, which is done in lateral view, and the course of the catheter is from the femoral artery to the ascending aorta to the arch of aorta into the aortic root, and it shows opacification of the aortic root along with the coronaries. And if we see here, then we can see the one of the coronaries is only visualized. We cannot see the other coronary very clearly in the first angio.
Right.
And the aortic root appears a little dilated just above the aortic sinuses.
Okay, and?
And
if you just observe a bit more carefully, this also small puff of AR that you can see in this angiogram. I don't know if you noticed it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So like what you said, yeah, we were not very sure about the left coronary. So we have done a selective coronary injection in this case, just to make sure that the course is fine. So yeah, so we had the right coronary arising from the right sinus and the left coronary has been hooked again. So this has been done with a Judkin's right catheter, but in fact, both the left and the right coronary systems have been hooked with the Judkin's right catheter. And you can see the course of the coronary is being normal.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So there's nothing crossing the right ventricular outflow tract. Of course, we would normally want to do an try and obtain an on-fast view of the aorta in an AP caudal view as well. I'll probably show you that in some other angiograms as we go along. Okay, so now what do these show?
This is a aortogram, which is done in AP view and using a pigtail catheter. The course of the catheter is from the femoral artery to the ascending aorta into the arch, and it shows opacification of the aorta. It is right arch, and with the branching pattern. Actually, the video, sir, I can't see it very clearly. It's stopping in between. The first, I can see three branches which are arising, four branches.
Right.
But the first branch, I can't see. The left subclavian is not clearly visualized.
Correct. Fine.
And then apart from that, I can see one collateral which is coming down from the arch.
Okay. So with respect to the first one, so this was basically a descending aortogram. Of course, it's a right aortic arch, but this is not the view you would comment on the branching pattern anyways.
Yes,
so
sir.
If you wanted a right aortic arch and you wanted to know its branching pattern, what is the view that you would actually go to?
LAO 50.
With right left aortic arch, what view would you go to?
LAO 50.
You're talking of a left aortic arch or a right aortic arch?
Left, sir, left.
Okay, and if this is right aortic arch as in this instance?
RAO, sir.
Yeah, so the more RAO you go, you will be able to open the arch vessels better. So, of course, this did not have any other anomaly of the branching that we could make out. And if you had an aberrant subclavian or something, you would have seen it arising from here. And you can notice a few collaterals on this descending aortogram.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so the next thing that we need to do, especially in older children, is to make sure that the indirect collaterals are also looked for. And therefore, this we have taken selective subclavian injections. So what do you see here on the right side?
So there is we have given an injection into the collateral. It's a selective injection that we have given into the collateral, mm-hmm. which is arising, I think, most likely from the right subclavian. And it is going down and supplying the lower part of the right lung. And I think it's also crossing the diaphragm and going down. A small twig.
Yeah. So this is actually, if you see, this is an enlarged right internal mammary artery.
Okay.
It's been selectively cannulated. And you can, like what you said, it is going to the right lung. And also you can see some surface collaterals which are seen towards the periphery of the lung field. Correct.
This is a selective injection which is given by an end-hole catheter in AP view, and the injection is given, it is showing opacification of the left subclavian, and we can see the vertebral left vertebral artery also arising, and we can see the lima which is arising and coming down, and there is also a small meshwork of collaterals that we can see around the second to third ribs, second, third, fourth ribs.
I don't think these collaterals are significant, isn't it?
Yeah, they're not that significant.
Yeah. And what was the last angiogram that was done here?
This is a pigtail angiogram, sir, which is done in AP view. And it is showing a pacification. This is a innominate vein injection, which is done using a pigtail catheter. It is showing opacification of the innominate vein followed by the RSVC into the right atrium.
So is it important to do this in all cases, or is it optional?
So it's important to do, but here it is more common, we do it in all single ventricle cases mandatory, but here we are trying to see if there's an LSVC. So
if you have been able to image it on echo adequately, which I think we would in most present day circumstances, we would not really want to do an innominate angiogram in a case of TOF. But having gone inside, we have probably just completed the shoot to demonstrate that there is no LSVC. So the only thing is, if there is an LSVC in TOF, are there any concerns with any specific type of an LSVC that you would have?
If the LSVC is draining into LA.
Yeah, so if it's an unroofed coronary sinus.
Unroofed coronary sinus.
Yeah. In which case, you would have probably corrected the TOF. But
still
it was really, yeah. So there is a chance that you would miss that. So if you have not, if you pick up the LSVC on echocardiogram and if you see that the coronary sinus is actually not enlarged on echo, that's when you should be worried all the more. And you will have to confirm it by a contrast and, to show that whether it's really having any bubble of opacification of the LA, in which case the surgeon will have to address that as well. Okay. So I think, so to just summarize this was just a standard TOF angiogram, which was done in a 13-year-old. So what are the indications for an angiogram in TOF? Symptom for surgery without any further imaging apart from an echo, isn't it?
Yes, sir. So we have to look for the branch PA anatomy. Okay. Then we have to look for if there are any additional VSDs. Then we have to look for if there are any collaterals. Then we have to look for the coronary artery anatomy.
Correct. Yeah. So if any of these are a concern and you feel that it's not well visualized to an echo, especially in older children, you might want another imaging modality. Probably CT is better off in most of these cases today. But sometimes we do conventional angiograms as well. So this is the second shine.
Comment or anything.
Yes, sir.
It's a really good illustrative case. A tetralogy of color, Dr. Anand discussed every point actually. So indications and all, that nowadays the CT scan is the preferred choice. So significant collateral means whenever there is a pulmonary venous return should be there, or the collateral should be more than 5 French catheter size, or if it is not IMA, the collateral should be more than IMA size. Anyway, Dr. Anand, the angiogram showed that the right innominate artery is involved. So you cannot compare that. So these are the three important points, are more than 2 millimeter, people say. So pulmonary venous return should be there to call it a significant collateral. Just to give a teaching.
I think the pulmonary venous return would be probably the most important thing we have to look for.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So the next one, someone else can take it probably. Okay, should I go to the angiograms? Anyone could volunteer or
Good afternoon, sir. This is Dr. Kalyan, sir, from Kerala. Sir, this is a five-month-old child having a saturation of 85%.
Yeah.
So, child is taken for angiogram, and the first angiogram on the left side is showing a pigtail angiogram, which is done in AP view. The course of the catheter is from the descending femoral artery to the right-sided descending aorta. It's the descending aortogram, which is showing multiple collaterals, which are supplying both the bilateral lung fields, predominantly in the lower half of the right and left lungs.
Okay.
So, in the right lower angiogram, which is an end-hole catheter, again the course is.
Yeah. Okay. Are you done with the first one? There's some more information. So, in any case of pulmonary atresia, the basic idea when you're doing it in a five-month-old child, obviously he's tachypneic and saturating quite well for an atresia situation. So yes, you sir. Obviously know that the flows are relatively good. And in fact, some of these patients might present with heart failure. And I told you he had a continuous murmur which was heard all over. So the flows are definitely not reduced in this patient. So what is the main thing that you would look for in an atresia situation on an angiogram?
We would like to see the native pulmonary arteries and the predominant collateral, whether the collaterals are supplying to the native branch PAs or directly into the lung fields.
Yeah. Okay. So can you just look at the angiogram from what you said you have seen large collaterals supplying both the lung fields.
Yeah.
So are the native pulmonary arteries absent or what is it?
Sir, from the descending aorta on the left side, we could see one collateral which is supplying to the native branch PAs, which are very hypoplastic. So,
yeah. Identify the native branch PAs over here.
Sir, I'm trying to move with my this thing, but whether it is seen in the main screen or not, I'm not sure.
Okay, you can just describe it. Maybe I will show it if you can. So what's the, what is it called as? Angiographically, how do you describe the, is there any name given to that kind of an appearance?
Okay.
Anyone else wants to?
Like the seagull appearance.
Correct, yeah, the seagull appearance. So can you identify the seagull?
The one of the wings of the gull, like the pulmonary artery, it's going on the right hand side.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that is one.
Point it out to you. So this is where it is. Can you see? So this is the RPA and this is the LPA. So you see this structure, which is moving quite well along with the cardiac pulsations, whereas you see the rest of the collaterals, they're not moving with the cardiac pulsations. Do you see that?
Yes, sir.
Really, these are extremely diminutive native pulmonary arteries which are confluent and united by a very probably short MPA stump. So there's just a confluence which is seen here where my arrow tip is there. That's the confluence. So this, like what you said, is a large collateral. So it's probably getting fed retrograde and you can see that. So obviously the collaterals being posterior mediastinal structures, they don't move the way the pulmonary artery would move along with the cardiac pulsations. Okay, so this is important to know. And also you can see the venous return back in the levo phase into the LA and the LV.
Yes, sir.
So you have large collaterals, there's no doubt about it. And what we have done next is we have taken a selective angiogram into the collateral on the left side, which you can see supplies a considerable portion of the left lung, whole of the left lung probably, with some diminution probably to the left upper lobe. That area looks a bit lesser perfused.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
here
it is.
No. Who said that there it is? No, this is this one,
the first angio that is seen, these two are the pulmonary arteries.
No. This is not the pulmonary artery. So if you have seen here, we have gone from the descending aorta, isn't it? This is an end-hole catheter from the descending aorta. And this is hooked in.
Okay.
So you can't hook a pulmonary artery from the descending aorta, can you?
No.
Yeah. So this is not what I
said. It's a bifurcating collateral.
Yeah, so this is again a collateral. which is again bifurcating and going to both the lower lobes predominantly. And the next one on the right is again a selective subclavian shoot. And here you can see there's a large collateral which is actually quite odd in that it crosses from the left and goes off to the right side.
Yes, sir.
And with probably a very small twig supplying the left lingular lobe over here. Okay, and you can see all these collaterals have got very good pulmonary venous return in the LEGO phase.
Yes, sir.
So they are obviously not significantly stenosed. So this child is just 5 months old, but we don't know. Most of the times these collaterals can develop stenosis as the child grows older. So what would you want to do in terms of management for this kid?
As of now, sir, the saturations are more than 85%.
Correct.
If you have a MPA stump, then we would like to put a RV2PA conduit with keeping collaterals in situ so that the native branch pulmonary arteries will grow over a period of time.
Okay. So why are you doing it? Are you doing it because you said the saturations are 85%, so that's not really something of concern, isn't it? Are you doing it for the sake of saturation or you're doing it for something else?
It is because of to develop the native pulmonary arteries, as we can see very hypoplastic pulmonary arteries. Okay. So I thought of in view of to develop a growth of pulmonary arteries.
Yeah. So those native PAs are extremely diminutive. That will not be suitable for any future total correction if you leave them like that. And relying on these collateral sources to supply those pulmonary arteries is obviously not a good idea. One thing is because these collaterals might develop stenosis. And secondly, this child is a bit tachypneic. So we don't know, it's having some amount of heart failure. So you might have to actually give some medications for heart failure at the same time that you try and establish a more definitive shunt procedure. Either you can do a whatever, it depends on the center. Like what you said, maybe you want to do an RVPA conduit, but this is really very diminutive for a conduit. I'm not sure how many centers would agree to do that. Most places would probably place in some kind of a shunt to establish a controlled pulmonary blood flow and reassess the child maybe, 6 months to a year later to see how the pulmonary arteries have grown and what's happening to the collaterals and then plan a definitive repair. Okay.
Yeah. Plan of unifocalization, how it will be, sir?
Yeah, so good point you raised. So with unifocalization, so over here, if you actually see in this first case, so in the previous patient, the collaterals were large enough and supplying significant portions of the lung fields. We really don't know, we don't think that these diminutive PAs are going to contribute much in terms of lung perfusion. So either you just allow it to grow at the same time, grow for now with the help of a shunt and reassess maybe 6 months later, or someone is really comfortable doing a unifocalization in 5 months. Probably unifocalize whatever you can. I don't think the one from the left subclavian can be brought down so easily, but maybe the posterior mediastinal collaterals will still be amenable to unifocalization. And then you connect all of them to a definitive pulmonary source. And then you hope that the PAs grow. Okay. This someone else can take. This is again a 6-year-old girl. So she's cyanotic, saturating around 79%. And again, similar to what you saw in the previous first example, so the pressures in the ventricles are the same and the PA pressures are normal and the aortic pressure is normal and the right atrial and left atrial pressures are more or less equal. So does anyone want to interpret this and then we'll go ahead to the angiograms?
Sir, shall I take, sir?
Yeah.
I'm Arun from Jaydeva, sir. Sir, here in this patient, there is a... So in this patient, the RA pressure is equal to LA pressure of 6 millimeters of mercury and mean pressure is 5. So A wave is equal to V wave, which is abnormal in RA, but it is within the normal limits of the pressure. So likely to have a ASD, large ASD at... ASD. Then RV pressure and LV pressure are equal. So suggestive of a large non-restrictive VSD. And PA pressures are, RV pressure is elevated because of large non-restrictive VSD. And PA pressure is 12/6 millimeters of mercury. So the gradient from RV to PA of so likely to have RVOT obstruction, then aortic pressure is 90 by 60 millimeters of mercury, which can be normal. And so it is roughly RV pressure is equal to LV pressure is equal to aortic pressure.
Okay. Yeah. So an additional finding was probably a non-restrictive ASD in this patient.
Yes, sir. This one is the first one is the angiogram taken in AP view with the sir RV angiogram. It is showing opacification of there is coarsely trabeculated right ventricle. There is opacification of the pulmonary artery, right and left pulmonary artery, and also we can see aorta.
Okay.
Aorta, ascending aorta, we can see, sir. Ascending aorta opacification, we can see there is a large non-restrictive VST, thereby causing from LV to
Hello. Yeah.
Oh, hello. Hello. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What else can you see in that?
I think right pulmonary. I think there is only left pulmonary. Right pulmonary artery is not well visualized. Sorry, right pulmonary artery is well visualized. Left side pulmonary artery is not visualized.
Okay. Why is it? Why do you think that's happening? Anyone else wants to, is it similar to what you would expect if you do an angiogram for a case of TOF, this kind of an anatomy?
No, there is some difference. It is not what is expected in routine TOF, sir.
Yeah, what is different in this?
Maybe
left side opus,
yes, sir.
LPA appears stenosed or smaller size, because opacification of the left lung is there. It is not that it is totally absent.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Left lung arborization, it can be seen, but it is not as good as that of the right lung.
Okay, we got that point. Now I think you're going more into the minute details of it. What is most striking on this AP angiogram?
It's a malposed great vessel, sir.
Yeah.
Malposed great vessels. Yeah.
So where do you see the aorta here?
Sir, aorta is left and aorta is left and anterior.
Yeah, so if you look at the angiogram below, yes, that will help you to make that out as well. So in the AP projection, you can only say what is left and what is right. You can't really make out what
left
is
left. Yes, sir.
So here you see that the aorta is to the left of the pulmonary artery. That's not a normal relationship, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Normally the pulmonary artery would be to the left. So here the aorta is to the left. And like what you said, you have a pigtail catheter which has gone in from the IVC and across into the right ventricle, the morphological right ventricle, which is trabeculated. And you see that there is an opacification of the aorta and the pulmonary arteries. And?
Yes, sir.
What is it when you see on this? We have taken a lateral angiogram also. So,
yeah.
What does that show?
In lateral angiogram, aorta appears anterior, sir.
Yeah, so the aorta is anterior and the PA is posterior. So
posterior.
It becomes a L-malposed aorta, isn't it?
L-malposed aorta. Yes.
Yeah. So then what are you dealing with and where is the catheter actually gone through then?
So it is gone through. Okay. Sir, RA, then through VSD.
Yeah.
Through VST it has gone.
So VST into the morphological LV, okay?
LV, yes sir, morphological LV.
And this is basically a case of a corrected transposition. Yeah, you can actually see the conus over here which does not fill, separating the two great arteries.
Yes sir. Okay, So trabeculations is rest. This is LV, not RV, sir.
Trabeculations are
less trabeculated, more smooth. So it is LV. Initially, I told it as RV. That's why I told it LV. It is.
Which one are you seeing? Are you seeing the one in the front or the one behind?
In the first image, what we are seeing at this point of time.
Mm-hmm. So in the first,
that is LV.
How do you expect the LV to be normally in a case of a corrected transposition?
Sir?
Where would you expect the left ventricle to be in a case of a corrected transposition on a plain AP angiogram?
Sir, that's what I'm getting confused in, sir. Whether this one is LV or RV, sir, the one in which the pictorial catheter is placed right now. In CCTJ, it will be RV.
Yeah, so this is the RV. So the LV would have come more on this side. This is not that we would enter an LV in the case of a corrected transposition.
Okay, sir.
So this has gone in through the VSD, okay, into the right ventricle. And you can actually make that out better over here. And the RV is actually forming the apex. It's the same, we have not changed the position of the catheter. It's just taken in two planes. Okay, so the LV doesn't form the apex in a corrected PGA.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay, so yeah. Like what you said, you were concerned about the left pulmonary artery not being well opacified. So I think that's probably because of the overlap there. So what have we done next here?
So now we have gone from IVC to RA, then we crossed the VSD and then entered into morphological RV and entered into the pulmonary artery and taking the RV morphological.
No, you said it was a
corrected. No. So corrected. So no. LA. So we have entered from. We have entered from RA into LV and LV into pulmonary artery.
Yeah. So if you actually look over here, you see the acute bend of the catheter. So this is where LV is. This is where the LV ends. And it's just that the catheter has taken a more tortuous course because we have actually gotten into the left pulmonary artery to opacify that. Can you identify what catheter it is? Just as an additional point.
Is it balloon? Is looks like it Burman catheter, sir.
Yeah, but the balloon is deflated. Okay.
Balloon is not. Balloon is kept deflated.
Yeah. So this is just a hand contrast given after that. Burman catheter. You're right. Correct. So the arborization looked pretty good. So what to do for this patient next?
Arborization looks good, I see.
So you have this patient saturating at 76%. It was a 6-year-old girl. So what was your final diagnosis? You said it was CTG, VSD, PS. But yes, not CTG, VSD. Okay. So how do you want to manage this patient?
We have to consider for is a double switch with the arterials, so atrial switch and then Rastelli.
Yeah, so you would want to do a Rastelli with ascending. And another thing which you can notice here is the prominent shadow of the ascending aorta here.
Yes, that's sir.
The LMR goes to aorta on this side. Okay. So this was just one description, which because this is something that all of you get confused. And this is often asked, why you take only AP or lateral projections for corrected transposition? This is more the textbook anatomy. Of course, I've not done an LV angiogram in that patient, and nor was it looking very similar to this textbook picture. So you actually see that the plane of the IVS, if you're looking at it in the anterior-posterior projection, is banked from anterior to posterior, okay, from front to back. You have the LV on one side and the morphological RV on the other, and this you can see is the aorta which is coming off from here. So either you can profile this in the AP view, which will show it like this, or if you go to a dead lateral view, it will appear one behind the other, where the LV is posterior and the RV is anterior. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is an 8-year-old boy who had undergone some palliative surgery at 2 years of age. So I want someone else to take this.
This is an angiogram taken from AP view, sir. And the catheter is passing from femoral artery to the descending aorta to the arch of aorta, sir. Mm-hmm. And there is a left-sided aortic arch. And the injection is given in the arch of aorta. From there, one collateral is filling the pulmonary confluence, sir. From there, it is reaching the peripheral pulmonaries.
No, are you describing the first one or are you describing the second one? So the first one, like what you said, yeah, you have taken a catheter from the descending aorta and you have entered one of the arch vessels over there. And this is an end hole catheter, like what you can see. And obviously there's been some contrast which has been given through your
hand. There is a selective injection.
Okay, selective injection into the subclavian. So what do you see then?
From subclavian to...
So I gave you a background that this was an 8-year-old boy who was undergone some palliative surgery at 2 years of age. You can see the sternal wires over there.
BT shunt.
Yeah. Okay. So your idea was to try and visualize a BT shunt at 8 years before you want to send him, because you can't just send him like that based on an echo. You have to visualize the branch PA anatomy a bit more carefully, look for other collaterals which might have developed in the interim, and also visualize the shunt. So what have you done in the first angiogram?
Sir,
BT
shunt. Filling was not clearly seen, sir.
Correct. Yeah, so why do you think that's happened?
So maybe obstruction.
Look at the second angiogram. How does that give you a clue to the first one? I mean, as to why we have done the second angiogram? You are correct that the BT shunt was not seen well when you gave a selective subclavian shoot. So you hope to see it with that. What we see on the first angiogram, you see there are collaterals also which are coming down, isn't it?
Okay.
The right lung. So, what to the subsequent injection? We have actually kind of occluded the collateral with a balloon. So you can see this is the subclavian. This is a large tortuous collateral, which is arising from the base of this innominate over here. And if you can actually see, the innominate artery itself is dilated. Okay. It's dilated because it's supplying too many things. It's supplying the subclavian and the carotid arises from there. And it's also got a shunt and it's got a large collateral. So you have too many sources of blood flow there. Obviously, the vessel is going to get enlarged. So when you have these kind of collateral vessels, what the area of interest might not be well visualized. So you do a balloon occlusion angiogram where you kind of occlude one of the vessels, and when you give injection proximally, the structures are better seen. So if you actually see here, we have then taken a pigtail catheter back into the base of the innominate. And in this, once the collateral has been occluded completely with the help of the balloon, you're able to visualize the BT shunt from there, filling both the branches. Can you appreciate that now?
Yes, sir.
You can freeze that still picture, Anand. So that...
Here the collateral is coming from subclavian, sir.
Yeah.
That was occluded and main BT shunt is now filling.
Yeah.
And some wire is placed within the collateral, sir.
Yeah.
Which was tortuous.
The balloon has to be taken over the wire, isn't it? So the balloon has been taken over the wire. And then the balloon has been inflated. So this wire is lying distally within the collateral. And then you can see the opacification of the BT shunt better. Over here.
Okay.
Please.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Already I cannot listen.
Yeah, you're so small. Bring the volume up.
So what maximum, my turn.
Hello? Yeah. So, who was answering? I don't know. You can continue with this.
Yes. And an aortic shoot was taken at the level of descending aorta, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Which was showing the filling of the left pulmonary artery.
Okay. Left pulmonary artery.
Left
pulmonary artery is already filled through the shunt, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this descending aortogram was done basically to look for any additional collaterals, like what I said. So you can see one collateral over here, somewhere at the D6 level.
Yes, sir.
And which is giving off branches over here. And maybe retrogradely, it's also filling the native pulmonary artery. I'm not sure. And there is another twig of collateral over here. So obviously this child was had surgery. So this catheter, the angiogram was done, and also as part of, so here you can see the selective collateral injection being given over here.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here, so if someone wanted to see that tortuous collateral, which we entered with the help of a wire, you can see it on this first angiogram. And you can see that this is actually kind of supplying a portion of that right upper lobe and the middle lobe. Maybe some branches have been going to the lower lobe. And there is a venous return which is seen on the levo face. So extremely tortuous course of the collateral. And this was this thing closed with a, occluded with the help of a balloon to visualize the shunt. And what can you see in the other two angiograms?
Coil closure of the collateral was done.
Yeah. So coil closure of maybe not this collateral. So this was the
D6 level.
Yeah, the one which came from the descending aorta. Those two collaterals were knocked off. This was quite tortuous. So what was the plan? I mean, I'll tell you what was done for this patient anyways. I mean, that's written there. But how would you normally approach this case?
If PS are not developed, we can do unifocalization and then...
No, I show you the PAs. No? They were good sized. So the shunt is done well in this patient. I mean, it's helped grow the PAs well. So the only problem would be probably the additional collateral over here. But if you...
Collaterals, we have to close PA, and add it to PA conduit.
Yeah, so the native PA is also supplied this area. So probably the right upper and middle lobe have got a dual supply. So if you have a dual supply, you might be able to ligate off this collateral. So we asked the surgeon to ligate off this collateral, which was quite tortuous and arising from the base of the subclavian. And along with an RV2PA reconstruction with the help of a conduit and a VST closure, and the VT shunt was taken off. Okay, can we go ahead to the next one? So, okay, just another question. So, what are the other scenarios in which you would like to do a balloon occlusion angiogram? I mean, when others can take the question.
So, in relation to TOF or...
No, in general, and when you're dealing with structural heart disease and, you know, pediatric catheterizations, angiograms, when
ASD, adult ASD.
No, I said a balloon occlusion angiogram. What do you want to look for in an ASD with a balloon occlusion?
The
sizing of
PDA.
I'm not referring to sizing.
Look for LV, EDP.
No, I'm talking specifically with balloon occlusion angios. This was a balloon occlusion angiogram, isn't it?
To delineate the map cause, we have to do the balloon occlusion of the descending aorta and do the angiograms.
Okay, that's one scenario you might be able to do it. So what basically does is it helps you to minimize the contrast. So similar to the descending aorta, suppose you want to look at the coronaries or the arch anatomy in small infants. Again, you might be able to just occlude the arch or the ascending aorta just above the coronary origin and give a small shoot so that the coronaries are pacified better. The arch anomalies can be made out better if you occlude the descending aorta. Any other instance in this pulmonary atresia situation itself?
In TGA, to look for the coronary arteries, we can...
Yeah, so coronary artery anatomy, that was one thing. Again, when you have, see, in this case, you had multiple collaterals, isn't it? Now, suppose I told you that you have a dual supply sometimes. So how do you actually know whether it is a dual supply? Suppose you have two collaterals over here, which are supplying the same area, and you want to, you choose to knock off one of them, or you have the native pulmonary artery which is supplying. So you occlude one of them and you give the contrast injection. So then you will know what is inherently supplied by the native PA or that other collateral that you're looking at. Do you get that?
You also have to look for pulmonary AV fistula. You can selectively inject from balloon ampoule.
Yeah, pulmonary AV fistulas in cases of pulmonary embolisms. Yeah, so pulmonary AV fistulas, again, there is a lot of runoff. So you might want to occlude proximally and give the injection so you can see exactly where the feeder vessel is and where exactly the fistula is, where exactly the narrowest portion of the fistula is. That might be better appreciated. Okay, same with pulmonary.
During alcohol septal ablation.
Okay, what is alcohol septal ablation?
We'll proximally occlude the septal branch and we'll look for the supply of the area of supply of the septal one.
Okay. Then, as part of, even you can occlude even venovenous collaterals that very often develop in a post-Glenn situation. Okay. So, we'll go to the next case. Fine. So, it's 5 o'clock. So, just tell me, Kalyan, when I have to stop.
Anand, after this, probably 5 cases, sir. Okay, after this, you can stop.
Yeah, okay, fine. So then I'll probably skip this. I'll go to something which is probably a bit more rarer. Just let me see that.
I think you can speak now.
Yeah, no, I'll just go to some more. Okay, just anyone wants to identify what's done here?
So this is a pulmonary wedge angiogram that is being given.
What wedge?
Pulmonary venous wedge.
Venous wedge. Reverse.
Delineate the pulmonary arteries.
Yeah. So in cases where you don't visualize the pulmonary arteries, you might want to give a pulmonary venous wedge angiogram and look for retrograde opacification. So this patient, basically, we were not able to see the native RPA on echocardiogram. And actually, if you see even on the pulmonary venous wedge, we can't really make it out. Okay. So, yes. How to give a pulmonary venous wedge, I think you guys should know. Okay, this is a bit rare, but I don't know if you want to take this. Okay, let me just go to the data first. So, this was a 7-year-old boy with fatigue and cyanosis and dyspnea. So, this is his saturation data and hemodynamic data. So what exactly do you see here? What is striking in this?
PA saturation more than aortic saturation.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. So what does that indicate?
TGA physiology.
Yeah, it's a TGA physiology. Okay. And you can see that the PA pressures are around half systemic. So it's not that it's very high. And if you can, okay, look at this angiogram.
DORE, sir.
Correct. What is strikingly abnormal or rather peculiar about this DORV?
RV is filling the aorta directly, sir.
Yeah, so there's a significant amount of aortic override, okay? Almost to the extent of 90, it's almost like the aorta is entirely arising from the right ventricle. But despite that, what you strike notice that is that the relationship of the great arteries is normal. So the pulmonary arteries to the left, and when you look at it in the lateral projection, the pulmonary artery is anterior to the aorta. So this is the PA, and the aorta is posterior to it. So this is a case of a DORV with an extreme degree of aortic override and NRGA. And then I told you that the PA saturation is more than the aortic saturation. So how can you explain that? I think sir was mentioning that at the start.
Streaming.
Yeah.
Streaming, sir.
So this is an unfavorable that's happening in this patient. Let's probably go to one more example.
Sir, was it because of DORV with the subpulmonic VSD, sir?
No, it was not a subpulmonic VSD. This VSD was basically more in the posterior muscular location. It was more of a posterior muscular VSD. Okay. If anyone wants to just take this. Yeah, so you can see that there is a balloon dilatation being done.
The first angiogram showed a pigtail angiogram. The course of the catheter was from the IVC to the RV, sir, which showed a doming pulmonary wall with a critical pulmonary obstruction at the level of the valve. And there was a dilated main pulmonary artery and the left pulmonary artery, which can be even seen in the lateral view in the lower down film. So the procedure which was done was transcatheter pulmonary balloon.
Talking?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Jen, can you just want to look at it a bit more carefully?
Yes, sir. There is also a infundibular, I think, hypertrophy which was associated with that.
Okay. Anything else? Now, does the lateral angiogram at least give you a clue?
Yeah. The pulmonary walls are the pulmonary arteries are posterior, sir.
Okay.
And the ventricle is of smoothly trabeculated, which is LV morphology.
You see the septal surface over here. So this is what I said, a bang AP projection. So you are correct. So this is left ventricle, which is giving rise to the pulmonary artery.
Yeah.
And the situs is solitus. I'm not sure if you noticed that. You can see the left bronchus is more longer. So we've got a situs solitus with a levocardia. So the atrial situs is normal. And we've got AV and VA discordance. So
okay.
This is basically a case of a balloon pulmonary valvotomy done in a case of corrected transposition of great arteries. So any concerns that you might have following this procedure?
The risk of pulmonary edema will be there following the acute complete opening of the pulmonary wall.
Complete heart block.
So my question was not really with relation to the immediate concerns of that. Standard BPV complications. Anything else that you might foresee? Someone said complete heart block. That might happen during the procedure. It's a bit unlikely that if it's not happened then, that subsequently someone develops.
There is no VSD and PS is there, so LV regression happen after BP.
Okay, that is one thing. And what else would this kind of protect in the with regards to the natural history of a corrected transposition?
It can lead to pulmonary vascular obstructive disease due to increased pulmonary blood flow.
RV dysfunction and TR will increase.
Why would you have pulmonary vascular obstructive disease? This was a case of a tight PS in a 30-year-old lady. We have just relieved the obstruction. That's it. There is no VSD. So why are you thinking?
No VSD. Okay. No VSD means less likely to. It won't happen.
Early onset of RV dysfunction and TR.
Yes, sir.
Why should that give rise to early onset of RV dysfunction?
The PA band will protect the pulmonary stenosis act as a PA band, sir, which decreases the chance of RV dilatation and the decreases the chance of tricuspid regurgitation.
Precisely. So AV band regurgitation, this was something which was acting as a natural band for this patient. But this lady was really symptomatic, I'll show you. So we had no other option in this patient. So we have actually done the full calculation. You can see the QPQS is actually 0.5. So in the presence of an intact ventricular septum, this is almost behaving like a severe case of a triology of Pallot. You can see her SVC, IVC saturation is extremely low, so just a low cardiac output. We could not have just left her like that, thinking that what will happen to her future AV valve or whether she's going to be a candidate for a double switch. And considering that this was entirely valvar, the best thing was for us to do a pulmonary valvotomy. And if you actually see the pressure data over here, you can see the LV pressures are suprasystemic. RV is 120, which is a systemic ventricle. And it's come down. And another thing, if you notice here, both the RA and LA pressures had prominent A waves. Okay, that's because the EDPs of both the ventricles were high. This is like a real spotter. I'm not sure if anyone should have a doubt about this.
Sir, previous case, could you explain, sir, why left AV VR?
Okay, so basically in the natural history of corrected transposition of great arteries, the left, the systemic AV valve, which is usually on the left side in the case of a situs solitus position, may have epistenoid-like malformations and the ventricular geometry gets altered and you might have natural AVVR developing. So one of the ways to correct systemic AV valve regurgitation in the corrected transposition, they have tried PA banding, which kind of increases the left ventricular pressure, alters the septal geometry and might reduce the extent of AVVR. So this patient did not have any AVVR at this time, but now having relieved that obstruction of the left ventricle, the septal geometry might get altered. So we don't know in the future if she's going to have an AVVR.
Or can we do double switch instead of doing this PPP, sir?
Yeah, so double switch and X-ray is an extremely morbid procedure, isn't it? So when someone has lived to 30 years and we know that her situation over here is entirely valvular, why not give a chance at opening the pulmonary valve? Because we have relieved of her symptoms.
That is a fairly good argument that a double switch at 30 years of age is going to be somewhat very difficult because you don't understand the ventricular arterial decoupling at that point.
Yeah. This is, I think, a common spotter which is going to be kept for you in the exams in case we have this. So someone can just take this fast.
The coronary AV fistula.
Okay, very good. So how did you say that?
So because if we see here, the first angiogram that shows a pigtail catheter in the aortic root and the opacification shows that one of the coronaries is dilated and it is going and opening somewhere in either RA or RV inlet. That's not very clear.
Yeah. So she's 30 years and she had a continuous murmur on the left, second and third intercostal space.
Okay. Ananda, are you going to talk about that? I am not going to accept that.
Which one, sir?
This one, coronary AV fistula.
I'll just let them see the other angiograms.
Okay. I think you understood what I wanted to. Now study, you know, what is the angiogram which is done and what is happening? It's a beautiful angiogram, Ananda, I must say.
Thank you, sir.
We can't miss this diagnosis. Other people can do chatting. Don't answer, Anand. Let other people do chat box answers. Is it the last case?
I can end, sir, anytime you want.
You can end anytime when you want and students want, but I want to listen the answers from the students in this particular case.
Yeah.
Ooh.
You can go ahead, Anand. There are some mixed answers. You can go ahead.
Okay. I'm not able to really see the answers here. Okay. So what we have done is, okay, someone raised a suspicion of a coronary cameral fistula, considering that she has been asymptomatic at 30 years. And, you know, you had a murmur which was present in the second, third intercostal space. So you expected something flowing into the pulmonary artery. That's what we saw on the echocardiogram as well. But if you see here carefully, this is a selective right coronary injection which has been given. And you can see an extremely tortuous right coronary artery which is enlarged, multiple collaterals from the right system. And you can actually see a retrograde opacification of the pulmonary artery over here. So this was actually a case of an Al-Kappa.
Al-Kappa, okay.
So it's extremely rare, one of the rare scenarios where an Al-Kappa has been absolutely asymptomatic. This is probably because she has been so well collateralized. And this actually, in fact, behaves like a shunt. We had a QPQS fraction of 2.8:1 in this patient. So that is, again, extremely rare. And so the closest differential obviously would be a coronary cameral fistula. So how do you disprove that it's not a coronary cameral fistula? You have to basically show the origin of an LMCA from the aorta. So if you cannot show the origin of an LMCA from the aorta, and then also you have to look for the ECG. Now, retrospectively, I can tell you that the ECG did have small Q waves which were present in the lead 1 and V5, V6 and with some minimal ST changes as well.
Okay.
So she has been, she's one of the few people who have had a very favorable natural history.
Okay.
At least till now. I don't know in the long run how these dilated coronaries are going to behave for her.
Okay.
So this was a case of an Al-Kappa. So we tried our level best and there was nothing which was visualized from the left system was not opacified. Okay. So the left system could actually be, even you might try to cannulate it from the pulmonary artery. Now, how do you want to manage this case? Because she has been asymptomatic at 30 years. So do you just want to leave her alone? And this is her shunt fraction. And she just has a murmur. She was referred to us because of a murmur.
Sir, I think... that's a significant shunt. QPQS is 2.8. So I think we'll do a repair, we'll do a corrective surgery.
Okay. So is it just because of the shunt that you want to do a corrective surgery? I mean, she's asymptomatic despite having this kind of a QPQS.
But sir, the basically there is good collateral circulation which is there, but
so you know, she's obviously, if she's been without ischemia for so many years, you would presume she's going to be that way.
But sir, later in life, she might develop atherosclerotic changes and then she might become symptomatic.
Okay. So now someone said that, okay, you said that you want to just, one of the main reasons is you want to, because she has got a large shunt fraction, you want to obliterate that. So it was actually well, very well seen on the echo, even from the PA. So would it be possible that, you know, we just kind of put a device into the LMCA mouth and occluded that so that there is no more fistulous communication and the shunt is gone? I mean, those were one of the initial things which were done for Alcapa repairs, and we just ligated off the LMCA to prevent the steal. So if we could do it in the cath lab as an interventional procedure, go and put in a device and occlude the mouth of the LMCA where it's originating from the PA, would that be an acceptable answer?
I don't think so. We won't put a device, but
okay. So any reasons why would you not want to do that? Okay, one thing is, you like what you said, so I'll just give you, so if you look at the long-term data of patients who have undergone they've just ligated off the LMCA, there is a high chance of ventricular fibrillation and sudden cardiac death in these patients. Okay. So the choice of surgery for any Alcapa repair would be to establish a dual coronary circulation. A single coronary circulation is any day inferior to a dual coronary circulation. Secondly, like what you said, if she develops an atherosclerotic heart disease, God forbid, the RCA, she's going to have a very catastrophic event because her whole left system is dependent on the RCA. And you would not be able to access any of the left system. Suppose she develops some atherosclerotic lesions in the left system as well.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think this was kind of okay. I just want to just do one more interesting one, and then I think we'll end with that. Yeah, so just look at this data and tell me what's it. Okay, this looks like pretty normal data, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Kalyan, you're saying that, yeah. Everything is normal?
Yes, sir, except that there is a gradient of 13 millimeter of mercury across the pulmonary wall. Other than that, everything...
That's significant, 13 across the pulmonary wall.
That is acceptable.
That's acceptable.
And the aortic saturation is 98. So basically, this child just got referred to us because of a...
Innocent murmur, sir.
Innocent murmur.
Okay. So I'll just... But anyway, so we surprisingly took her to the cath lab.
LPA to LA
Who's that? I'm sorry.
But LPA to LA won't have 98% saturation.
Correct. Okay. Someone said LPA to LA. So just read the angiogram the way you know, just go the way, follow the catheter course, and then you just describe it.
So shall I go ahead?
Yeah, go ahead, Palak.
Okay. So this is a angiogram which is done in AP view. It is an end hole catheter. The course of the catheter is from the femoral vein into the IVC, into the RA, into the RV. And we have given an injection which is showing opacification of this ventricle, of trabeculated ventricle, most likely the right ventricle, which is giving rise to both the branch PAs.
Yeah.
And the levo phase. The levo phase is showing the filling, the left sided pulmonary veins, the right sided pulmonary veins are seen, which are draining into directly into LA. Mm-hmm.
And then the LA to LV.
Yeah.
And then the LV to V.
LV to aorta, but aorta is like, sir, is it like the descent? It's arising and then it is descending onto the right hand side.
It's descending onto the right hand side. Okay.
More like a circumflex.
But if you actually see the IVC is here, isn't it? So still the aorta is on the left of the IVC. Yeah. And you can make out the liver shadow here, and you can make out the stomach bubble here. And if you look at the bronchus again over here, this does not look like an abnormal situs. Okay, you can take some clues from the angiogram below, Palak. And also there's something else, okay, which you said. You said about the descending aorta. What about the ascending aorta?
Yeah.
Again, look at the position of the ascending aorta.
Yes, sir. It looks a little higher up.
Okay. So in an AP view, like what I said, you again look at what is left and what is right. So what is left and what is right here? This is the pulmonary
artery. The aorta looks towards the right only. So the pulmonary artery looks towards the left, I think.
Pulmonary artery is here, no? And this is the aorta. This is the ascending aorta.
Yeah.
So the ascending aorta is to the left.
Is on the left. Yeah, yeah. Ascending aorta is on the left.
Seeing your corrected transpositions, isn't it? We showed you quite a few examples earlier.
Yes.
But only thing is that here the RV is coming from, PA is coming from the morphological RV, you said. And this is definitely a smooth walled LV, which is giving rise to the aorta.
Yeah, yes, sir.
And if you look at this lateral angiogram, you can see two catheters placed.
Yes, sir.
So, which is more anterior?
One is an end hole catheter, which is most likely placed in the PA.
Yeah, that's in the PA, correct.
And second is the pigtail catheter, which is placed in the aorta.
Correct. So?
And they look side by side, so more of. I can't differentiate if any of them is anterior, but maybe the aorta is a little anterior.
Yeah. So you don't have too much of a space here, isn't it? So you see the, this is the sternum. So the retrosternal space is occupied by the aorta. You don't have another great artery coming there in front of it.
Yeah.
So side by side, you would have to see if you're talking in terms of an anterior posterior relationship. There you already said that the aorta is to the left.
Left. Okay.
And the pulmonary artery is to the right.
Right. Right.
And now the aorta is anterior. Aorta looks anterior to the pulmonary artery.
Pulmonary artery.
Yeah. So what is this position of the aorta?
L-malposed aorta.
It's an L-malposed aorta. But then I showed you the data earlier, which showed everything to be like almost like a normal heart. So now any conclusions that you can draw?
So is it isolated AV discordance?
Anatomically malposed aorta.
Yeah. Who said that? Yeah, I see isolated AV discordance. What would be the saturation column?
Yeah, it will be 98%. Yeah.
Okay, so this was basically a case of an anatomically corrected malposition of the great artery.
Okay, ACMG.
Yeah, an SDL. So this was an ACMG, yeah. SDL yeah. Morph. Okay. Yes. I think I'll stop, sir. I think we're done.
It is very good illustrative series of tetralogy of allo, and then other cases are very good actually. I am sure that a lot of students got benefited. Today, close to 120 students attended and listened to your class in the peak time. But most of the time, it is more than 90 people all over the country. Very good angiograms, and it is going to be useful from exam point of view. I am going to request you one more class some stage, maybe in the next couple of weeks or so. I request you to keep interact with the students in the WhatsApp group also. You can also post that passively, you can do, not necessarily you can do actively also.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, Anand.
Any comments about the angiograms that I've shown? Any comments or teaching points that you would want to share?
Wonderful. Actually, I was listening most of the things. A couple of occasions, I just went outside.
Yeah, but okay.
They are very good angiograms. So only one request is frame rate is low or your computer RAM is a little bit slow.
Yeah, probably the RAM is.
Maybe you did not upgrade your computer for a long time or something. Something like that.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a wonderful teaching, actually. I think people like you should involve in the teaching, and I'm sure a lot of students are getting benefited. Thank you, Anand. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll end the session.